صلى الله وسلم عليك يا رسول الله وعلى أهل بيتك المعصومين المنتجبين يا ليتنا كنا سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله، السلام عليك يا ابن رسول الله، السلام عليك يا ابن أمير المؤمنين، السلام عليك يا ابن فاطمة المظلومة، ما خاب من تمسك بكم وأمن من لجأ إليكم. يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز والله فوزا عظيما. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يوم يأتي لا تكلم نفس إلا بإذنه فمنهم شقي وسعيد. آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوات اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد. For the love of Abba Abdullah al-Hussein, with the loudest of our voices, صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد. For the love of Hazrat Ali ibn al-Akbar, with the loudest of our voices, sallu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. And for the purification of our hearts and the hastening of the reappearance of our beloved awaited Savior, Abba Salih al-Mahdi, with the loudest of our voices, sallu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Assalamu alaikum jami'an wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuhu. Once again, we thank Almighty Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala for giving us this wonderful moment to continue seeking His nearness through the values taught and established by our beloved Master and Savior Abba Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi afdalu salati wa aska salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. The verse I've just quoted from the glorious Quran is Quran 11, verse 105, Surah Hud. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala in this beautiful verse highlights on the importance of success and failure, where He says, يوم يأتي لا تكلم نفس إلا بإذنه. A day will come, no soul shall speak or talk without His permission. Then He says, فَمِنُهُمْ شَقِيٌّ أَوْ سَعِيدٌ. Of those who will gather on that day, meaning the day of Qiyamah, There will be group of wretched, those who fail, the failures. And then there will be the group of successful ones. Now, departing from this beautiful verse, our topic of tonight is successful personality. And the examination of tonight will be of the following three stages. The first stage, we look at the essence of success and the types of success. Second stage of the examination, we'll then discuss the principles of success and how to embark on a journey of achieving true success. Then the last stage of our examination, we'll look at success in the legacy of our beloved first Imam Mawla'i Kainat, Amirul Mu'mineen, Salawatullahi wa Salamuhu Alayh. You know, brothers and sisters, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala is merciful. Allah is love. And Allah wants each and every one of us to achieve success, be it in dunya or akhirah. Hence, when He created us, He provided us with fitrah. The work of fitrah simply yearns for perfection. When I and you go out of our houses every single day to our works or to our studies or to meet our friends, what we are doing is seeking success and nothing else. Is seeking perfection. The drive behind our movement from one place to the other in trying to achieve success is this fitrah, which is given to us by Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala out of His infinite mercy and love for all of us. Allah, brothers and sisters, loves us so much. We cannot begin to imagine Allah's love for us. You know, one day a lady went to our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. When she went to the Prophet, she said, "Ya Rasulullah," companions were sitting next to the Holy Prophet in his mosque in the holy city of Medina. She said, "Ya Rasulullah, I'm hungry. I have two children. We've not eaten. We need your help." Prophet called people of his house. "Whatever is in the house, bring it. Let us give to this lady." So they brought bread. So Prophet gave the bread to the lady. Kindly pay attention to this story. It will demonstrate to us how Allah loves us, and that we cannot settle, but to ensure that our love for Allah manifests in each and every aspect of our lives. Prophet gave the lady this bread. What she did was she divided the bread into three. She kept one piece and the two pieces for the two sons. The sons immediately finished their pieces, and the lady was still holding hers. What did she do? She divided a piece into two and she gave to the sons. They immediately finished their pieces again. So Prophet looked at his companions and he asked them, "What have you observed?" They said, "We've observed love." Then he said, "Wallah, Allah loves us more than the way this lady loves her children." Allah wants us to achieve perfection. So first stage of the examination, what is success? Najah or sa'ada? And what are the types of success? We all want to achieve success in life. So it's important we examine the importance of success and how to achieve it within the religion of Islam. You know, there are these two terminologies, Fawz and Azima, we've just recited, isn't it? And then you've got either Sa'ada or Najah. Englishman will translate success. Fawz, success. Sa'ada, success. Najah, success. But when you come to the Islamic perspective, Islamic teachings, Islam looks at these terminologies differently. When we talk of fawz, it's temporary success. But najah is something higher, or sa'ada, than fawz. Sa'ada or najah, my dear brothers and sisters, it is composed of four things, four elements. Kindly pay attention to these elements. When these elements are found in each and every one of us, be rest assured, you are on your way towards achieving success. The first element is hadafiyah, having aim in life. Your father or your mom are sending you to university, and you're going to undertake this particular course. What's your aim? Why are you going to that particular university? And why are you undertaking this particular course? Having very clear aim in life, in whatever you do, is a sign of achieving success. That's first element. And we'll expound on this later, inshallah. Second element, sakina, calmness. You know, as they said, chilled. You have to be a chilled person, relaxed. Anyone who is chilled, calm, relaxed, is an element of success. Because you cannot be at peace with me if you are not at peace with yourself. You cannot be at peace with the members of the community if you are not at peace with yourself. Peace begins with you and it ends with you. So, peace is of great importance. It is an element of success. Third element is intajia, productivity. Being active is different from being productive. There are many who are very active but less productive. There are people who spend sleepless night doing things, but at the end of it all, when you go to look at it, there is no productivity. Productivity is an element of success. It is not the amount of hours you spend on doing or in doing something. It is the product you come with. So productivity is an element of success. I mentioned last night here, youth is someone who is productive and creative. That's the psychological definition of who is a youth. You cannot, under any circumstance, claim to be a youth when you are not productive and creative. Whatever you do in life, ensure that you are productive and you are creative. You know, just to share a beautiful tradition with you from our beloved fifth Imam, Imam Muhammad al-Baqir, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. So our beloved Imam mentioned, oh my Shia, he was talking to his lovers and followers, go around. When you come across a Shi'i Ithna Ashari youth who is not productive and disciplined, bring that Shi'a youth to me. I, Baqir, will discipline him. So productivity is an element of what? Success. The last element of success is what? Tahqiqudhat. Finding your path. Finding yourself. Finding your passion. Quran is very clear. 75:14. بَلِ الْإِنسَانُ عَلَىٰ نَفْسِهِ بَصِيرًا. Can't insan be judged against or over him or herself? One ayah says, وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. In yourselves, can't you see? So to find your path and to find your passion is an element of success. How many go to university First year, tick. Second year, tick. Third year, daddy, mommy, I want to change my course. It means the person has not found his or her path before. How many people, that job, no, that job, no, that job, no. Some people cannot sustain one thing in their lives. Finding one's path is of great importance in helping us become people who are able to sustain things in our lives. And from here, scholars examined the types of success. Kindly bear with me here, and I humbly seek your indulgence. I begin with a scholar, is Iranian psychologist who lives in the United States, Holakai. He said there are two forms of success. We have najah nisbi and najah hakiki. Relative success and real true success. And beautifully, the way he explains, I love it. He said relative success, you look at different communities. You look at eastern part of the world. You look at western part of the world. They have what they consider success. So you look at the eastern part of the world. He said, in the eastern part of the world, when you have three letter ha, you know, ha, ha. When you have three khas in your life, you have achieved relative success. Number one, ha, khun. Blood, meaning what? Your kabila, your family. Which family are you coming from? He said, family is a great contributing factor towards achieving relative success. Khun. He said, the second akha is hawk. Your land, your country. Which country are you living in? He said, that country constitutes the level of your success. And the third one, he said, khuda. Khuda, that's kha, isn't it? Khuda, God. So when you have khun, khak, khuda in your life, according to him, you have achieved relative success. He said, when you come to the western part of the world, three things are needed for one person to be regarded successful. Number one, power. Number two, wealth. Number three, fame. When these three are together, you are a celebrity, isn't it? You achieve success, but relative success. And he said, in some other part of the world, your success is determined by the levels of your knowledge. But then according to him, real true success is when you combine what we've just mentioned. But Islam looks at this differently in a very profound and beautiful way. I'm going to humbly refer you to a verse, and I'd like all of us to focus on the verse. We're going to make a little bit of journey through this verse to understand what is success in the sight of Almighty Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. And that whatever we do in life, we should ensure that it connects us and it makes it easy for us to achieve that true real success. You know, in sociology, there is a theory, Nazariyatu Imtidad al-Wujud, the theory of love for expansion. All of us, we love to expand. We love to grow. There is no one who come and tell you, you know, Sheikh, now I don't need money anymore. I think I've got enough. Even our senior citizens, sometimes they tell you, know what? Alhamdulillah, I made it in life. They still look for money. Those who are famous, they want to become more famous. It's nadhariya to imtidad al-wujud. In other words, we all love life. Baba, there's no one who come, no, hubbu dunya, hubbu dunya. Everybody love life. It only depends how you relate to that hubbud dunya. Because at the end of the day, I can only build my akhirah in this dunya. And our beloved Chief Imam, Imam Jaffar al-Sadiq, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. Beautifully mentioned, this dunya is the mosque of the true servant of Allah. He said, true servant of Allah, wherever they are, it is mosque for them. So dunya, it depends on how you relate to dunya. But you know what? All of us sitting here, from our children to our wazirs to our senior citizens, we do not express our love for life the same or on the same level. Which verse? Quran 57, verse 20. Kindly pay attention to this verse. This verse, my dear brothers and sisters, highlights on how each and every age group express their love for life. First part of the verse, Allah says, "Wa'lamu annama al-hayatu ad-dunya la'ibun." The verse is here on the screen. Note that the life of this dunya is play. It's a play. Now you see, not every one of us express our love for life by playing. When you delve deeper into this verse, you realize that it is talking of children up to 7 years of age. They express their love for life by playing. So you have your children, you go to the shopping mall, what they ask for more, buy me more toys. That's how they express their love for life. You come home, they are trying to, you know, to mess something in the house. You stop them. By the time you finish going somewhere, they start messing something else. وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنِيَا لَعِبٌ. That's number one. Number two, Allah says, وَلَهُنْ. لَهُنْ here, I translate to be amusement. What is amusement? To consider what is secondary, primary, and what is primary, secondary. Not everyone expresses his love for life through amusement. Who do that? Adolescents and teenagers. Those of you who have teenagers, you know. Sometimes you see this is black, but they tell you it's white. No, this is good for you. No, Baba, you don't understand. Walahun. So those of that age, that's how they express their love for life. What is secondary becomes primary to them. What is primary becomes secondary to them. So therefore, you have to take it easy with them sometimes. Third one, wazinatun, beauty. We've got group who express their love for life by beauty. I want Timberland. I want Boss. I want V6, V5, I don't know, X5, X6. The father wants to buy something, he said, buy this one, that. Don't buy that one. Which age are we talking about? 20 above, up to 30, towards between 30s, in 30s. That's how they express their love for life. Beauty. Everything has to be beautiful. Their bed has to be something very unique and beautiful, according to their own definition. The fourth one, Quran says, وَتَفَاخُرٌ بَيْنَكُمْ, and mutual rivalry. Who express their love for life through mutual rivalry? Those in their 40s. I'm better than him. He is better than her. I want to show that I'm better than everyone. So those in their 40s, they express their love for life by mutual rivalry. Look at the last one, senior citizens. وَتَكَاثُرٌ فِي الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَوْلَادِ, boasting with abundance of wealth and children. The senior citizens. You know, our elders, when they see their sons, mashallah, performing well, they say, who is this chokro? Who is this chokro? Whose son is this one? Better? Mashallah, I'm happy. Better, you are doing well. Our parents, that's how they express their love for life. They look at the bank account, they become excited. They look at the children, they become excited. I moved from Uganda. I came to Toronto, or I moved from Kenya, I came to Toronto, Sheikh, I had no education, but look at my children. That's how they express their love for life. You know, it's not a bad thing. Elders love money. They may not spend it, but they love it. Sallallahu Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Brothers, ya Ali. Brother, may I request everyone to stand and move forward? There's no space at the back at all. Please, brothers, if you can just stand and move forward, please. But Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad, salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Thank you.
So our senior citizens, that's how they express their love for life. But now there is something here we need to pay attention to in a moment. You know, when a person becomes old, what he or she does is to make sure his or her name or the name of his family remains intact, even if he's not in this world anymore. So you realize in their will, they will establish a corporation that let the family business continue. If it is Kanji, let the Kanji name continue. If it's Nanji, let it continue. If it's merchant name, let it continue. You know why? Because they believe there's success in it. If the name continues, even if they are not alive, that is a great success. My children will continue with the legacy of the family. You know what Islam says? Islam says these are all successes, but they are relative and fake successes. Children playing is a success. Mutual rivalry is a success. Boasting of wealth and children is a success. But Islam says this is relative success. Come Islam, what is real success? Real success, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala makes it very clear in Quran. If you look at Quran 16 verse 97, مَنْ عَمِلَ صَوَلِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ فَلَنُوحِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبًا. Whoever does good, whether male or female, and they are believers, Allah says, we will grant them good living. Good living, according to Islam, is a real success. What is good living? Peace of mind. How many people own mansions, but they can't close their eyes at night? How many people own literally nothing, but when they go within seconds, they start snoring? Success is itmi'inanul qalbi. It's inner peace. Whatever you do in life, do it. We mentioned last night. Climb the ladder. Go higher and higher and higher. But note that that is relative success. It has to connect you with the real success. Your wealth is not the aim. It's means to the aim. Your fame is not the aim, it's means to the aim. Your children are not the aim, they are means to the aim. Your knowledge is not the aim, it's means to the aim. What is the aim? Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. That's why Abu Abdullah said, taraktu al-khalqa turran fi hawaq wa aytamtu al-ayala likay araq. وَلَوْ كَتَّعَنِي بِالْحُبِّ إِرْبَى لَمَا مَالَ الْفُؤَادُ إِلَى سِوَاكَ. Abdullah alayhi salam said, تَرَكْتُ لَخَلِكَ تُرَّمْ فِي عَوَاكَ. Ya Allah, I've left everything of this creation because of you. وَأَيْتَمْتُ الْأَيَالَ لِكَيْ أَرَاكِ يَا اللَّهِ. I am making my children orphans because I want to see you. He said, Ya Allah, if they will chop me into pieces, my heart will not divert to anywhere until I feel you are with me. So real success is it may not. And this inner peace comes through the remembrance of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And that is why Quran on numerous occasions is very clear on this real success. You find one verse, chapter Yunus, you look at Yunus, verse 62. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, Inna awliya Allah la khawfun alayhim wa la hum yahzanun. Allah's true lovers and servants, there is no sorrow nor grief for them. But come to Aba Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam, Surah Al-Fajr, verse 27, going, Ya ayyatuhan nafsul mutma'inna, irji'i ila rabbiki radiyatan, nafsul mutma'inna. Greatest verification of this nafsul mutma'inna is Aba Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam. So our efforts and our strive, my dear brothers and sisters, young and old, is to achieve real success. Use your work and whatever you do in life to achieve real success. And believe me or not, you can do it if you are determined. Now I'm going to share, inshallah, some practical tips with you. And that is the second stage of the examination. How to embark on a journey towards achieving true real success in dunya and akhirah. Principles of success. First principle again, tahdidul hadaf. We mentioned earlier. Identify your aim, I beg you. If you are to conduct a survey, what's your aim? What's your aim? You will be shocked that many may not know their actual aim in life. So the first thing is what? Identify your aim. You come into this majalis, for example, what's your real aim? What's your real aim? You traveling to that place, what's your aim? Baba, you are now in this world, what's your aim? What's the plan next year? What's your medium, short, and long-term plans? Do you have a plan? What's the plan? Give me your plan. Or are you just going with the caravan? Each and every individual must have a plan. You must identify your aim in life. At work, what's your plan? Where do you want to see yourself in the next 5 years? In the community, when it comes to your Islamic knowledge, what's your aim? You are embarking on your university studies. In the next 3-5 years, you're going to graduate. What's the aim? You getting married next year. What's the aim? Tahdidul hadaf. Identify your aim. And I cannot overemphasize on the importance of identifying our aims, especially amongst our youth. That's number one. Number two, tahdidul awlawiyat. Identifying one's aim is not enough. You have to identify your priorities in life. What are your priorities? You've got so many things on the table. You want to achieve that, you want to achieve that. Okay, fine, I agree. What are your priorities? As communities, what are our priorities? You as your family, what are your priorities? We need to be able to identify our priorities. Number three, practical principle towards achieving success is what? Believing in oneself. Athika to be that. Here, believing in oneself does not necessarily mean you do not consult. Does not necessarily mean you don't go to those who have experience in life to help you. It simply means believe you can do it. Quran makes it very clear. والذين جاهدوا فينا لنهدينهم سبلنا وإن الله لمع المحسنين. Those who strive in our way, we will guide them towards our way. Believe in yourselves. Have this can-do spirit. And when you have that, you will see the wonders of Almighty Allah, Tabarak wa Ta'ala, in our lives. The next principle of success is what? Determination. Don't be lazy. It's easy to be lazy in this day and age. It's easy to have weak willpower. Be determined. Strive. Simple example, Thomas Edison. We heard of Thomas Edison, who invented electricity, isn't it? You know how many times he failed in trying to invent electricity? I was reading that he failed so many attempts, so many years, and eventually he achieved the success. There's one Chinese, Holange the name, if I get it right, that he realized that his town, there was no water. So he tried for more than 30 years to get water for his town. And eventually, after 36 years, he got the water for his town. Today, we get tired easily. We give up easily. As a mu'min, as a lover of Aba Abdullah, you can't give up easily. I know it's hard sometimes. You try and it's not happening. Don't give up. Keep knocking that door. Keep striving. Keep determining. Eventually, the door will be opened by Allah. You studying, you're not getting it. Failing. You applying for jobs, you're not getting it. You applying for papers, you're not getting it. Don't give up. Sky is the limit because Allah is watching. That's why Abu Abdullah said, made it very clear. He said, whatever is happening to me in Karbala, I, Hussein, found it so easy because I know it is under the watchful eyes of Allah. So determine. Don't give up. We give up easily because we are in the world of instant gratifications. And because of this notion of wanting to be recognized, we tend to give up. Quran makes it very clear. It is only the one who does not believe in Allah gives up easily. The next principle of success is what, mu'mini and mu'minat? Ittikhadhu al-qarar. Take decision. Take decision. Be bold in taking decision. Don't allow shaitan to play with your mind. Consult elders. And I want to really advise myself and my dear youth, don't think you are independent. Don't think you can do it alone. The one who sleeps before you wakes up before you. It's a saying. The one who sleeps before you wakes up before you. I may be small shack sitting here on the member, but my fathers and mothers, I cannot merge and get to the level of their experiences in love. So before you take decision, consult your parents. Consult elders in the community. It is of great importance, Amir al-Mu'mineen mentioned, not me, that an opinion of an elderly person is so dear to me. It's like an idiomatic expression or a metaphor than the skin of a youth. Meaning what? This elder, he is full of experience. And these, our elders, they are the think tanks of our communities. I don't believe they are on the departure lounge. Because some community, you go, they say, senior citizens, they are on the departure lounge. Very soon, Azrael will come in, la ilaha illallah. No, they are not on the, these are the think tanks of our community. Consume, absorb from them before it is too late. If you do not take from the elders, you regret. And likewise, elders, try to also understand this new generation. So therefore, taking decision is of great importance. A last principle of success is what? As you go about your lives and taking decisions in your life, remember very well, one, Allah has right over you. Your body has right over you. Your family have right over you. And your entire life has right over you. So these are the principles of success. Now, how do I embark on my journey towards achieving success? Kindly pay attention to these practical tips. Number one, you need expertise. Okay, you're going to pursue medicine at uni. Do you understand what you're putting yourself in? You are applying for a job somewhere. Do you understand what you're putting yourself in? Fine. I want to become the leader of the community. Do you understand the sickness of the community? You know what the Holy Prophet said? And of course, Amir al-Mu'minin described the Holy Prophet. Huwa tabibun dawwarun bitabba. Prophet alayhi salam is a medical doctor who circulates with his medication. Meaning he understood the people he was leading. So first practical tip towards achieving, whether dunyawi success or ukhrawi success, have expertise, knowledge of what you want to do. Without expertise, it won't work out. Second practical tip, be smart. This world, wallahi, if you are not smart, you will be swallowed. Wake up from deep slumber. Be smart. Read and understand things. Process things properly. Don't just follow the caravan. Be a very active person in your life. So you need to be smart. You need mahara. And to be smart, it requires a lot of effort in our lives. Number three practical tip, focus. Many people don't have focus, unfortunately. As I mentioned earlier, they want to do 1,000 things at the same time. Focus. Do due diligence to what you are doing before you move somewhere, Habibi. But if you divide your attention, you may not achieve all at the end of the day. Number four, be authentic. You have to be authentic. Unfortunately, today, people are not authentic out there. You look at Facebook, most of the things really are not authentic, Habibi. Wallah, there are people who are dying from mental health because of what they see on Facebook. Because you and your family have gone to Maldives for holidays, and they cannot afford Maldives for holiday, and you post it there, posing like that, they are seeing and they are crying in the house. You posing with your children, it's fine, it's your prerogative, I agree. But be mindful of the right of those who watch. And that might not be authentic. So we have to be ourselves. We have to be authentic. Wallah, when you are authentic, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala help you. Don't take yourself where you have not reached. Be where you are. And wallah, the first to appreciate you will be Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Now, last but not least, practical tip. Be ready to accept the responsibility. Because now you have the expertise. You are determined. Now be ready to accept responsibilities. I've put myself in. I'm involved in these studies. Be ready to accept that responsibility. Last but not least, let's come to the life of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Ahlul Bayt are our role models. We cannot do without Ahlul Bayt. All that we have discussed. Now let us look at it in the sight or in the lens of Malaika in us. Number one, we mentioned, identify your aim in life. You know what Amir al-Mu'minin said? Man awma'a ila mutafawitin khazalatuhu al-hila. Whoever wants to look at so many things at the same time without focusing on one thing, his or her trick will destroy him. Yani Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salam is trying to tell us, focus. Focus, do it well. And from one, you then move to two. But now you want to do that, you want to do that. Amir al-Mu'minin said, you will end up regretting. Number two, Amir al-Mu'minin said, be positive. I beg you, brothers and sisters. I know it's hard. Life can be difficult. Maybe you're trying to get married and you are not getting it. Maybe you are going through so many financial challenges. No, maybe you are on drugs and you're trying to stop, but things are becoming cumbersome, tedious. Maybe you are on alcohol and you're trying to stop, but things are becoming very, very difficult. Be positive. Don't give up. Whatever you do, wallahi, be positive. Maybe commotion in the family, husband, wife fighting day by day. Be positive. Keep trying. You know what Amir al-Mu'minin said? I found it really fascinating. He said, "Tafa'alu bil khayri tanjahu." Be proactive in doing khair. You will achieve success. Don't give up. It's hard. I'm sitting here, I know it's easier said than done. But wallah, insan, sky is the limit. My dear youth, you are the future of this community. You are the future of the madhahab of Ahlul Bayt. Ladies and gentlemen, try not to give up. Try to be optimistic reasonably. Try to be positive. Ahlul Bayt were positive. Amirul Mu'minin want to see us positive. He doesn't want to see us broken. Don't allow someone to break you down. When they try breaking you, say to yourself, sky is the limit, Allah is there, and I will get there. Bihaqqil Husayn alayhi salam. Be positive, according to Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salam. Number three, from Imam Ali, salam Allah alayhi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Learn from your experience. You failed last year. Are you learning from it? Your father spent so much money on you, and you lost everything. You're coming back again. Have you learned? Your boss caught you cheating, and he forgave you. Have you learned? You were not praying at all, and all of a sudden you started praying Allah's blessings. Have you learned? You know what Imam Ali said? Beautiful. Wallah, beautiful. He said, anyone who fails to learn from his experience, he will not be able to see the danger coming towards him. When istagna ani tajarubi, amiya alayhi al-awaqib. Learn from your experience, habibi. We all have pasts. Imam Ali. So whatever you do, learn from experience. That's number three. Number four, we mentioned earlier on, but look at what Imam Ali says. Learn from those who are experienced. You cannot run a community or a family with disintegration between the older generation and the younger generation. You have to bridge gaps. You as elders, don't be stingy in sharing your experience. They don't come, go to them. Prophet did the same. You as young, don't think because you have MA, PhD, you are better than your parent and elders. Seek the experience. Imam Ali said, beautifully in a tradition, he said, there is no success like learning from those experiences. Learn. And then the next line, Amir al-Mu'minin said, productivity is a way of achieving success. You have to be productive. You went to work today. Were you productive today or not? You came for majlis. Was majlis productive or not? You need to be productive, according to Amir al-Mu'minin, alayhi salam. Now, last but not least, Imam Ali did not just speak. He applied this in his life. Look at knowledge. Imam Ali, alayhi salam, was determined to impart knowledge. To such an extent, he would say, Saluni kabla antafkiduni. Ask me before you lose me. He would say, there is knowledge here. I wish this knowledge has careers. Imam Ali would put his fist in the ground to say, maybe the ground can absorb my knowledge because people are failing to absorb this knowledge. He was determined to give, to share. And he have a point here. There are good members of our community. You've got expertise. You've got experiences. Either in finances, in whatever. Go out there, share with the members of the communities. That's one example from Imam Ali. Practical example. Another example from Imam Ali is willpower. Baba, look at the willpower. He slept on the bed of the Holy Prophet. That's willpower, that's determination. Number three example is his ubudiyah, servitude to Allah. He worshipped and worshipped and worshipped and danced on his face. Prophet approached him. He said, Kum ya Aba Turab. Stand, O Aba Turab. Referring to Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salam. But now look at how Imam Ali empowered his companions. That's success. Look at the level of his companions. You look at Rushayd al-Hijri. You look at Umar ibn Hamak al-Khuza'i. You look at Maysam al-Tammar. You look at Kumail ibn Ziyad al-Nakhai. You look at Salman al-Farisi al-Muhammadi. Look at the companions of Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salam. He built them. You as an elderly person in my community, what legacy are you leaving behind? Is it only about your family or no? You manage to build forces that you know when you meet the Holy Prophet, you tell the Holy Prophet, I built some members of the Shia community. Let's follow Ahlul Bayt. That's what success is all about. And so therefore the garad, the aim, of tonight, this course is what? You cannot achieve success without effort. Because success is sifatu nafsi, is psychological condition. It's not actual condition. There are two conditions. This is my last point. Actual condition, typical example, sickness. It's an actual condition. I don't need to pay attention to know that I'm sick. You are sick. You're sick. You don't need to pay any attention. I'm healthy. I don't need to pay attention. I'm healthy. I know I'm healthy. But success and failure is a psychological condition. I need to pay attention to what is making me successful. Otherwise, I will still regard myself bad back to accuse my word of each other. These are your people, they complain, whereas they have success. Baba, if you have Hussein in your heart, cry for what? If you have Ali in your heart, cry for it. Take a deep breath in the morning. If you feel the love of Ali is still there, make long sajda and thank Allah. That's success. It's a psychological condition. You have the opportunity to go to universities. Billions of people across the globe cannot even complete primary school. Will you complain? So it's a psychological condition. You have to make efforts. And that's why when somebody asks you, define success for me. Success is less than ugly. It's intellectual tastes or intellectual entertainment. What is intellectual entertainment or tastes? You work for it. Example, then we go to Masai. Inshallah. Say you travel, say, from Vancouver or Edmonton, driving. And it's hot. You come back home, you call your wife or your husband. John, can you offer me a cold glass of juice? Because it's hot. When you drink the juice, how do you feel? You feel good. How long does it last? 30 minutes? The orange juice will go. That's what they call sensory tastes. Sensory tastes is temporary success. Here we are talking of intellectual tastes. What is intellectual sex? Say you are a banker or an accountant or you are a Maulana. Somebody comes to you with a very complicated masail. One of those ones. And yani, very difficult one. You try to call the office of Aga, you're not getting them through, man. You call and they tell you, borrow Fardobio. Go call tomorrow. For example. But then eventually you succeed. How do you feel? You feel good. That is intellectual taste. You work for it. Success is not cheap. You need to fight for it. And when you fight for it, you will enjoy. And Ahlul Bayt demonstrated this on the plains of Karbala. And tonight is the night of Hazrat Ali ibn al-Akbar alayhi salam. Brave youth, great personality, true lover of Aba Abdullah. He did not say, Aba Abdullah is my father and that's it. But he played his part. Let's take our heart, mu'minin and mu'minat, to the holy land of Karbala. He is the first of Banu Hashim to become shaheed on the 10th day of Muharram. And it was no doubt difficult for the family of the holy prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. He woke up in the morning and he recited the adhan. So can you imagine hearing your son reciting adhan for the last time? Hence when Ali began Allahu Akbar, all of them began to cry. Tears began to overflow from their eyes. Abu Abdullah taught us, Ali ibn al-Akbar alayhi salam is the closest to the Holy Prophet in his akhlaq, in his intellect, and in his look. But let's begin the masaib of tonight like this. You know, one marja narrates. He said, one day, I saw Aba Abdullah in my dream. But when I saw Hussein in my dream, I saw him in a pool of arrows. Arrows all over the body of Abba Abdullah. He said, the next day, I saw him again in my dream. But this time around, I saw only two arrows. So I asked him, Ya Abba Abdullah, yesterday I saw you in a pool of arrows. As some scholars will describe, Abba Abdullah on the 10th day of Muharram, he was like a hedgehog, surrounded by arrows. He said, O Mawla, I saw you last night surrounded by arrows, but tonight only two arrows on your body. What was the response of Abba Abdullah? He said, the tears of my Shias wiped off all those arrows you saw. But there are two arrows. Those tears cannot wipe them off. One arrow is the arrow on the neck of Ali ibn al-Asghar. And the other arrow is the dagger on the chest of Ali ibn al-Akbar. And that is why when Imam Zainul Abidin came to join the head of Abba Abdullah to the body of Abba Abdullah, he heard sound coming from the side of the father. Oh Zainul Abidin, place the infant on my chest and place Akbar by my feet. Abba Abdullah said to this Mawlana, these two arrows are my pains, and the tears of my Shias cannot wipe them off. Narration mentioned Ali ibn al-Akbar alayhi salam recited the adhan on the 10th day of Muharram. Salat was performed, isn't it? Later on, it was his turn to go to his father. As we mentioned, according to the narration, the first of Banu Hashim. Kindly pay attention to this, Masai. He came to his father. Oh, my beloved father, grant me permission to go. We are told in the narration, for every single companion who came to Abba Abdullah, Abba Abdullah said to him, go sit behind. I am the target. You are not the target. But for Ali, Abba Abdullah did not hesitate even for a second. He said, Ali, go. Ali, go ride your horse and go. Narration mentioned Ali now went to ride the horse. As Ali was riding the horse, he called out, Ali, come back. When Ali came back, he said, Ali, go to Khaymaga, go to Mukhayyam, go to the tent, go to your mother Layla, and go to your auntie Sayyida Zainab, go and bid farewell. Narration mentioned, Ali went to the Khaymaga Mukhayyam. The moment he entered, they all began to cry, because they knew that was the final moment seeing Ali alayhi salam. Ali bid farewell. Narration mentioned Ali came out. When he came out, he hugged Abba Abdullah. Both Ali and Abba Abdullah began to cry. The father bid final farewell. He said to Ali, now you can go. Now look at this, Masaib. Fathers, mothers, you know what I'm talking about, isn't it? As Ali was going, Abba Abdullah was walking slowly behind Ali. Abba Abdullah then called out, Ali, come back. Ali looked at the father. He said, father, haven't you granted permission? He said, Ali, may Allah never show you a moment where you know when your son goes, he will not come back again. Marishi mentioned Ali then went, Allahu Akbar, ajrukum ala Allah, mu'minin and mu'minat. Layla, according to some narration, came out of Khaymaga. and she had no energy to look at the battlefield. She would only monitor the complexion of the face of Abba Abdullah. All of a sudden, Layla saw the complexion of the face of Abba Abdullah changing. She called out, "Ya Abba Abdullah, is Ali alive or dead?" Abba Abdullah said, "Ummi Layla, go sit, make dua. Allah promised to answer the dua of a mother for her son." That was the moment she made the famous dua, "Ya Allah, you were the one who returned Ismail to Hajara. Return my Ali back to me." She said, "Ya Allah, you were the one who returned Yusuf back to Yaqub. Return my Ali back to me." We are told before she could finish the dua, Ali came back. But when Ali came back, he was calling, "Al-Atsh, Al-Atsh, Al-Atsh. Thirst, thirst, thirst." And he called out, "Oh my father, the heat of Karbala is burning me." He said, "Oh my father, the armor is killing me." He said, "Oh my father, I am thirsty." But look at the love of father to the son. Abba Abdullah placed his tongue into the mouth of Ali. Ali looked at the face of Abba Abdullah. He said, "Father, your mouth is drier than my mouth." Abba Abdullah then said to Ali, "Ya Ali, go, you will soon meet Rasulullah, and Rasulullah will quench your thirst." But you know how they finish off Ali, isn't it? Allahu Akbar. May Allah grant us sabr, inshallah. Ali fought and fought. Each moment he will call out, "Assalamu alayka ya abata ya Abba Abdullah." But the enemy lifted his dagger and he dagged on the chest of Ali. Because Ali fell down in the beginning, because they struck the arrow from behind. As he was on the ground, they dagged the dagger in his chest. We are told in the narration, the dagger appeared from behind. But as Ali was going through that pain, he called out, "Assalamu alayka ya abata ya Abba Abdullah." But look at the scenario. Imam Hussein, upon hearing the voice of Ali, he came out. For every companion, Hussein will rush to the body. But for Ali, Hussein began to walk slowly to the body. And you know what happened? Abba Abdullah came out and took wrong direction. Who called Abba Abdullah? Sukaina. She said, "Father, father, where are you going?" He said, "Sukaina Jan, I'm going to the body of Ali." She said, "But father, Ali is that side. You are going this side." He said, "Sukaina, it kills me to know Ali is dying." Abba Abdullah slowly walked to the body of Ali. But he was used to Ali hugging him with two hands. But he realized from far, one hand up, and the other hand wasn't there. When he got closer, he realized Ali was covering dagger with the right hand and lifting one, because he was dying. They dug the dagger. He was going. He was lifting the hand in show of respect for the father. One poet mentioned, when Abba Abdullah stood and faced towards Najaf al-Ashraf, one poet mentioned, "Ya Ali, you lifted the door of Khaybar with your hand. Come and see your son lifting dagger from the chest of his son in Karbala." final moment of the life of Ali. Ali would smile and Ali would cry. Ali would smile and Ali would cry. Abu Abdullah removed the dagger. He removed it. Abu Abdullah asked Ali, Ali, why smiling and crying at the same time? He said, I smile because I see Rasulullah. But Baba Ali Jan, why are you crying? He said, I cry because I see Fatima slapping on her cheek. Allah la'natullah. Allah la'kum izzali. Inna lillah. وإنا إليه راجعون وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد أي منقلب ينقلبون يا حسين.